Hello, hello. This is the 11th episode of Princeton Startup TV, coming to you from Foster City, the offices of Redbeacon. Today, our guest is Aaron Lee. He's the co-founder and CTO of Redbeacon. Prior to that, Aaron was one of the founding engineers on Google Video, as well as tech lead on YouTube monetization team. Before joining Google, he worked on Bosch, building one of the most advanced 3D navigation systems for in-car infotainment. Aaron received his Ph.D. in computer graphics from Princeton as intern at NVIDIA, Microsoft Research, NASA, and Lucent Technologies. He earned his master's and bachelor's at University of Cambridge with first honors in computer science. He holds 4 patents with 7 others currently pending. Aaron, welcome to the program.
Hi, welcome, Anand. Well, very nice to have you here, and welcome to Redbeacon.
Awesome. Let's get right into this. What is Redbeacon, and how did you and your co-founders decide to build it?
Absolutely. So we actually founded the company in year 2008, and that was the time when like me and my co-founders, Yaron and Evan, that were thinking about, hey, like we've been working in Google. I worked there at Google for about 4.5 years. Mm-hmm. And it was the time where you're kind of feeling the entrepreneur itchiness mm-hmm. to like kind of go do something new. And then we actually look at around the market, and also like we brainstorm a few ideas. And one of the idea that we actually look at was like local services. Mm-hmm. And we look at how actually fairly broken as it is. You have like Craigslist, you have Yellow Pages, and we figure out like, hey, it's like 21st century, and yet we just do not have a way to request a service like for the consumers mm-hmm. to get the pros to come and do the work for them.
Right.
And we start building the platform, and in the beginning, we actually open up to everything, meaning you could request a math tutor, you could request a tennis coach, you can get a plumber, you can get an electrician, you can get anyone. Mm-hmm. And we started with that idea, and the idea is really connecting the consumers who have a need to the pros that can serve the need. And that was a really, really basic idea. Mm-hmm. And the idea is like based on the location, based on their skills and all the other attributes, we match them.
Right.
Okay. And so we started in 2008. We almost spent a year and a half like building the product before we launched at TechCrunch.
Yeah, TechCrunch.
Mm-hmm. That was the year in 2009, almost end of 2009, mm-hmm. we first launched in the Bay Area. Mm-hmm. And we won the TechCrunch Award, we got a lot of attention, we start slowly building our presence from metro to metros.
Right, so you mentioned that it took you guys a year and a half mm-hmm. to before launch. How did you validate the hypothesis?
How did
you make sure that you have like product market fit? Mm-hmm.
So one of the things that we spend a lot of time on mm-hmm. is we constantly iterating the product, and mm-hmm. also we are talking to our potential customers. Mm-hmm. Like to give you an example, like when I was building the product, I attend one of the San Jose Home Show, which is a show for the pros that are selling to the like homeowners. So I went there and talked to the pros and tried to understand where are they getting their clients, where are they getting the business. How much are they paying? Are they using Yelp? Are they using Yellow Pages? Mm-hmm. Are they using like word of mouth? How does it work, right? And then you pitch the ideas to them, mm-hmm. right? We're not trying to like run it in the stealth mode and say, hey, I'm not gonna tell you my idea.
Sure, sure.
So we actually tell them, look, I mean, this is what we're trying to do. What do you think? How much do you think is reasonable? Like this is our kind of like rough business model. Would you be interested to sign up? Mm-hmm. And that's how we kind of test the market. We also show the product, a very early version, the alpha product, to our friends and families mm-hmm. and get them to play with it.
Did you notice any any demographic which kind of really this idea really resonated with? Were these plumbers or were these like tennis coaches, or that's kind of, was it more horizontal?
So it's interesting. Adoption? So we started like by thinking about building it as a platform, right? You say, uh-huh. look, I mean, it's just a request and response, kind of like you send out the RFP, request for yeah. proposal. Mm-hmm. And we start saying, look, I mean, we accept anyone. Like, in fact, the very, very first job was someone who asked for a delivering a Big Mac meal on the breakfast from McDonald's.
Awesome.
And that was really interesting. But slowly, when I start looking at our traffic, so we're very data-driven because all three of us are we're coming from Google, and we start analyzing the types of jobs that would resonate, like because that is kind of the demand coming from the customers. And it turns out that 80% of these jobs are home services or home-related services. And there's a very, very long tail that go from like finding a auto mechanic to like tennis coach to like getting an accountant for your tax purposes. Like there's a very, very long tail, but to serve the long tail is actually a lot of work because the product, because we want to build a generic platform. So we do not have features that are very like specialized and go deep into the vertical. When we build this generic platform, like you're trying to please everyone, and at the end you don't really please anyone. And once we figure out the data and also the kind of the incoming traffic, and also when we do a survey, like we figure out that like the home or the home services market is actually very, very big, and our estimate is about $160 billion.
Wow.
And right now, it's super, super fragmented. You have Angie's List, you have Surface Magic, you have like Google and Yahoo and Bing and Yelp and Yellow Pages and Craigslist. It's just so diversified. And
right.
I don't think there's a clear winner today. Like if you ask people and say, hey, where do you buy your books or, you know, electronics, people say Amazon. But when you ask people, like, where do you go get your home services?
Right.
It's all over the places.
What mistakes did you make along the way, and what did you learn from it?
Right. So I think if I would have to go back in time, like kind of knowing what I know now, the biggest mistake that we built was we built a generic platform. We did not address, like if you talk to a customer, it's like, I don't really care what platform you build, right? Can you solve my problem? Can you solve my pain point? And if I can go back in time, I think we would start with focusing on the most pressing need for the customers, like what can we do to help them solve their problems, rather than saying, like, hey, we're building a platform that is going to be good for everything for everyone.
Right. What was done right along the way, do you think?
I think we did a couple of things right. Like we built a very strong team. We have a very strong sense of mission, and we tackle a very, very challenging problem. And I think that was one of the things that, like, when we started the company, we wanted to make sure that we're not solving a very easy problem. Meaning, we're not gonna make like sharing on Facebook easier, right? like, we're thinking like, how can we impact a lot of people? How can we change people's lives?
Right, software eating the world kind of ideas. Coming from like yourself individually, I mean, do some angel investing on the side, and DiffBot, I guess, is one of the companies you're in.
Yeah, DiffBot is one of them, and the other one is Cubotics.
What do you look for in the companies you invest? And
so typically the way I talk to the companies, like before even doing the investment, so I would just talk to the founders, and one is I try to get to know the team and the person better, and the other thing is to try to figure out what they are trying to do, and I think the most things that I'm focused on is really the people and also the space that they're in. Is it a big enough space? And if both are true and there's a good vibe between like the founding team and me or the founders, and also I believe that I could add values to the company, that is where, like, typically the process will go from between 3 to 6 months, and then like I would decide to either put in my time or my investment into the companies.
Makes sense. Kind of taking several years back, it will be really interesting to hear about your experience working at Google Video and YouTube, and maybe share with some of the lessons you learned building the kind of the biggest video platform on the planet.
Yeah, I think I joined Google in early 2004, and when I joined, Google had about 2,000 employees, and it was a great company, amazing company, and I mean, like, I gave like awful lots of credits to the founders, like Larry Page and Sergey Brin, to build such a strong culture company, to still maintain the startup kind of like culture and the mentality, even when you get to 2,000 people, because it's not a small number. And when I joined in, they really did not have a project for me. They're kind of like, hey, like, we have the web search, we have image search, and we think video is gonna be becoming like the next thing. Why don't we do something about it? And in fact, we actually tried multiple projects in the beginning. Mm-hmm. Like Google Video was not the first project.
Right.
Right. So the first project was, I don't know if people remember, we digitized some of the TV content and we extract the thumbnails and the caption on it. So we actually be able to build a search engine on some of the TV content.
Wow.
And unfortunately, due to the copyright and all the DMCA, then we could not launch the product. And so we start thinking about like what else can we do. Mm-hmm. And so we actually launched a user-generated kind of site, very similar to YouTube. We also launched a premium content. So we work with, I think one of the first partners was Charlie Rose. So we got his content and we make it available. People can download to the desktop. And
was it mid 2005 or?
I think it's like 2005, 2006. Early 2006, like that's when we launched the Google Store or the video store in CES. And so that was some of the exciting times. As you can see, like we were actually building like different kind of products like based on what we learned from the customers. And of course, like we fail a few times along the way. And when Google acquired YouTube, the rest becomes history.
Right.
And YouTube brings a lot of eyeballs. They brought in a lot of traffic. The only slight problem is like there was no mechanism in place for like generating the revenue. As you understand, the cost of streaming and uploading and serving the video is extremely expensive. So we're trying to figure out a way on how we can basically break even the system.
Yeah. So when you were like early 2006, YouTube was gaining popularity, but was still not part of Google. What do you think was the driving force behind kind of YouTube's success back? Was it the early like first mover advantage, or was it a flash?
I think that the multiple things, right? I mean, like the first thing is like the internet or the bandwidth becomes more and more available. Like the market is getting to become more mature, right? That's one thing. And that could not have been done like 10 years ago. And in fact, I think like Silicon Graphics tried to do it like at some point, like maybe late 1990s. And it was very, very expensive. Like the pricing and the cost effectiveness is just not there. So that's one thing. The second thing is like, if you remember back in that day, those days, like YouTube was one of the, you know, kind of like hundreds, if not like many video
Daily
startups.
Motion was very
Daily Vimeo. Motion was like in France was also one of the very, very popular website. Vimeo is another one. I believe like you guys are using Vimeo.
Yep.
And it's just they cater different demographics. But back in the old days, it was like a lot of competitions. I think the team did an amazing work. Like I think Steve and Chad, like they led a very good team. Like they were some of the ex PayPal folks. Like very, very smart people. And they build a platform that allows very, very scalable way of serving and uploading like videos in a cheap way without breaking the bank, like before they get acquired. And on top of that, I also believe in the beginning, because they accept like all kinds of content, so that really enhanced the virality of the content. And whereas Google was very like kind of like strict on the content policy.
Right. You made sure that you have partnerships with us.
Exactly. Yeah. We make sure that like we talk to like those companies or content producers, and we really want to follow the protocols and the rules so that we have like we can bring those like content to our users.
That makes sense.
But I think it's the timing, it's the market, it's the infrastructure, it's also the people that have like the appetite. Now like watching video is becoming actually a lot easier.
Right. Wow. You did a Ph.D. in computer graphics. And what are some of your memories of doing Ph.D. at Princeton?
So first of all, I love Princeton. I mean, it's one of the great places that you can study and work and hang out with people. And I think the really the best memory is I love like pretty pictures. And that's what can draw me to computer graphics. And when I spent my 4 years there, I had a great time. And one of the things, like in graphics, there's an international conference called SIGGRAPH. Mm-hmm. It's a special interest group mm-hmm. for graphics. And it's very competitive, like people really work hard for that. Mm-hmm. And I guess the biggest thing was like I almost didn't sleep for 3 or 4 days, like just to hit the paper deadline. Yeah. It's crazy because you work in the lab and we're using silicon graphics like O2 and some of the workstations, and you have like the whole like graduate students, the whole graphics group, they're all working together for the deadline. It's just like amazing.
Yeah, it's like teamwork.
It's just like a teamwork, and like people work there like days and nights, like put all nighters, like 3 days, 4 days in a row.
Wow.
Yeah.
Do you still keep in touch with your lab mates and your
advisor? Yeah, I kept in touch with some of them. Like some people went to Pixar, which is one of the very, very good company on doing computer animation. Some people went to Apple, some people like, you know, went to SGI and do some great work.
Yeah. What did you work on for your PhD dissertation? What was your topic?
Okay, so the topic that I did was trying to basically digitize the 3D meshes of the 3D models. So the idea is, you know what, like when you try to send this like very complicated high detail 3D models across the internet, you need to send a lot of polygons when you animate them. You mm-hmm. need to like animate a lot of points and vertices and all the triangles. Mm-hmm. My dissertation was focused on how we can simplify the model so that you can like have a different level of details to the point where you have a very simple polygon, you can send this across the wire, and you can compute the delta encoding mm-hmm. so that you only send in the differences rather than the entire model, and you can like progressively refine the model as the viewers or the gamers like walking closer to the model. Right. So it was more like a mathematical representation on that, and I published a few papers on SIGGRAPH as well. Mm-hmm. And during that time, I was working with some researchers at Microsoft and NVIDIA mm-hmm. and I tried to bring these kind of concepts into like DirectX and some of the SDK.
Got it. Now let's, if we take more of a career advice and personal growth theme here, if you could have dinner with anyone in history, who would those people be?
Well, I mean, the first one that came to my mind is really like Steve Jobs. Like, I'm a big fan. Like, in fact, my first computer, my personal computer, uh-huh. was an Apple IIe. And so I started like doing this like kind of like 6502 assembly programming and basics and all this stuff and plotting a circle on the screen. It was amazing. Uh-huh. But what really, really impressed me was the fact that he can bring together the technology to the humanities. I think that is mm-hmm. really, really like difficult. Like, it's easy to make technology, right? I mean, it's like a semiconductor, it's a manufacturing process. But to make an interface so that you can touch people's lives and so that you can like bring people's like experience into the technology, that is not easy. That's very difficult. Yeah. So that's one. The second one that came to my mind was Leonardo da Vinci. Like, he is like probably the smartest guy and the most talented guy.
Fully math, yeah.
Right. Because like he was a great painter, he was a sculptor, he was a mathematician, he was an engineer,
he was
an architect, he was an anatomist, he
had entrepreneur.
Like, exactly. Like he was like actually everything.
Yeah.
And to have so much diverse interest and expertise in so many areas, it's just amazing. So that would be the second person. Mm-hmm. The last one is kind of like interesting. It's like more like Jesus, because I don't know whether he's real or not, and I just want to find out what the deal is.
That's great. Yeah. From the people you've met in your life and you worked together or attended a talk by, who impressed and influenced you the most?
I think my if you look at my career, it's a very kind of non-linear path, right? Because I spent a couple of internships during my graduate studies at NASA Ames, at Bell Labs, at Microsoft, NVIDIA. And there are many, many people along the way. Mm-hmm. Like, I think there was a saying like the reason I can see further because I was standing on the shoulder of a giant.
Yeah.
And there were so many mentors like that I really, really appreciate, because I like they helped me so much in my early days and mm-hmm. kind of like shaped my path. Like, one of them was my advisor, like Professor David Dobkin. Mm-hmm. And Wim Swelden, he was at Bell Labs, and Peter Schroeder, he was at Caltech, and Hughes Hoppe, he was at Microsoft Research, I believe he's still there. Mm-hmm. And there's just so many like amazing people that like helped me along the way to shape my thinking. And I think the probably one of the person like when I start working in the startup and later on joining Google was like Larry Page, because Larry will always tell us like, look, you need to think big, like like don't think about incremental steps, because like that's for the big companies. They can make things like really, really like good, but they're like really incremental thinking. Now, if you want to disrupt the industry, you need to come up with something like, you need to like think from the ground up, like from scratch, and it needs to be a very, very big idea. And that's why you see some of the innovations that are coming from Google, like the self-driving car, the Google Glass, are going to be something that will kind of like change the industry.
Yeah. Which five books shaped who you are and effectively changed your life?
It's interesting because I'm actually reading fewer and fewer books, because I think the internet is just a great way of you know, finding the content. And I'm also like finding it, like the books, I think some of them are very good, the classic ones, but really the up-to-date information are really on the internet, because by the time you publish a book, it's already like 4 years later, because the whole inefficiencies in the publishing industry, I mean, we're getting better, you have the e-book, you can do self-publishing, but still, by and large, all the material like could be found on the internet. In fact, like Google is one of the good examples, like almost the information is at your fingertips.
Right. Well, any blogs you follow?
I follow a couple of them, but like I think like Mark Andreessen, they have the
P-Marker. Yeah.
P-Marker is one of them. The firm like A16Z is another one. There's a VC by
Fred Wilson.
Wilson
another
one.
Yeah, Square Ventures.
I use like Flipboard. I use
Hacker News probably.
Yeah, Hacker News. I use. It's just a variety of things.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
What are the quotes you structure your life around?
So I actually have one quote on my LinkedIn profile, which is, if things are under control, you're not going fast enough.
Ah.
So that was kind of like every time, like it actually applies to your life, it applies to your work, it applies to your projects, it applies to your startup that you're building. It's like, if you feel like, hey, everything is going smoothly, that means you're not taking enough risks. You're not pushing the envelope. You're not like really pushing your team or yourself to the boundary.
True.
Like, things are just like going normal. Yeah.
Yeah. Innovator's dilemma. Yeah. In which areas, work-life balance or academia or maybe possibly learning new languages, any life hacking projects, any lifestyle design experiments you want to do, would you like to improve?
So I kind of missed it. I think the thing that I really miss is talking to people. I think like as you're like kind of like head down building a product, like there's an execution phase that like you say, okay, like I need to focus, I need to execute, and we a lot of people forget about the people element.
Right.
And even as we are building our product and kind of integrating into Home Depot, it is like we are learning every day, like everything is so different because the change in the technology, the change in the landscape, the change in the consumer behavior. They used to go to the shopping mall to buy stuff. Now they can do it with the mobile phones, right? That changed the behavior. Like when you talk to these people, like you learn so much about like shaping your product. And I think that is the part that I miss a lot. And I think like we should all spend more time talking to the people.
And realize their problems. Yeah. A day in life of Aaron Lee. How does your typical day look like?
So it's interesting because like I actually don't like meetings. So if you look at my calendar, I have very, very few meetings. And I even tell the team like I don't do one-on-one meetings. Now you would wonder like, so how can people talk to you? How can people communicate with you?
Right.
I actually sit in the open area like any other engineers. And when people have ideas and when they have like, you know, questions, they just come and talk to me. It's a very natural flow of conversations. It's not about, hey, it's like first day 1 o'clock, I need to come up with something to talk to Aaron for the next hour, right? That's not what we're trying to do. So we have this like small tech team that we just work together, and So then almost no meetings, unless there's some kind of like monthly or weekly catch up. We do have an agile kind of like stand-up meeting every Monday at 1 o'clock for 15 minutes, but that is just to bring all the team together to let everyone knows what they're doing. So my day in life is really simple. Like, I will focus on what are the most important things in the morning and try to figure out like how to get it done, and work with the team, talk to the people, understand the problems. And we do have these like quarterly and monthly goals, but by and large, it's a very dynamic process. So every day is a little bit different.
Majority is maker schedule. You try to maximize your time.
I'm trying to maximize my time. I'm trying to focus like what is the biggest impact, like to the company, to the team, to the culture, and everything.
Yeah, a little bit about it, calls it like MIT, most important tasks.
Yeah.
Make sure that you do first things first, like first hit them in the morning.
Because it's always easy to do the easy things, right? You feel like, hey, I'm achieving a lot, but you're, at the end of the day, you figure out that you're not really getting to the most important task.
Yeah, absolutely. It's kind of a futuristic, I guess. The question is, if you were 20 again, and knowing everything you know now, would you do anything differently? And what would you do if you were 18 again, let's say, fresh out of high school?
I think it's a good question. I mean, like, I probably will, I mean, knowing what I know, I think if you look at like the past like 10 to 15 years, there's really a significant change in the society, in the technology. And I probably will, like, knowing what I know, I will start like figuring out what are those opportunities and be able to like leverage those. But on the other hand, like, no one can predict the future. The only way you can predict the future is to build the future, to create the future.
Yeah.
So I actually, I wasn't too like bummed on saying, oh, like, I should have known that better. And in fact, like, today, every day is just, like, if you look around, you can already see so many interesting opportunities that you can like build a product, you can build a tool, you can build a business to help these people. And along the way, you will find your satisfactions.
Finally, what's the most important trait for an entrepreneur to succeed, according to Aaron Lee?
Well, my look at it, it's really simple. Right? I mean, there are a few things that, like, if you want to be entrepreneur, like, first thing is, like, you need to find something that you're passionate, right? I mean, forget about, I'm not even talking about like the market size or the biggest financial reward. It's just find something that you feel so passionate. And say, wow, I mean, no one else is doing it. I got to do something about it. And the reason is simple, because when you start building a company, like, even the smartest guys, takes them about 2 years to go from a concept or from a conceptual stage to something that's like beta quality product,
right?
Because it does take a long time to iterate, to filter your idea, to get better at it. So if you're not working on something that you're passionate, like, you're not going to be able to like persistent on it, right? So that's number one. And number two is really like the people. Like, when you build a company, it's really about the team and figuring out like the vision of the company and what is your mission, and be able to really convince the people to come and join you. That is really important. So, like, you can think about it more like that's a sales kind of like attribute, right? You sell your idea, you sell your company. But that's not really sales. It's more about, if you have the right mission, if like the mission is so good, people will just follow you. People will just come and want to work for you.
Right?
So that's number two. I think number three is like really like trying to surround yourself with a lot of like smarter people, like smarter than you. Because a lot of time, like, people tend to have like pretty big ego. They think like, oh, like, by asking this question on the forum, it makes me feel like I'm not intelligent enough. But that's not true. Because the more questions you ask, there's no dumb questions, there's only dumb answers.
Right.
So the more you can surround yourself with the smart people, and you'll be amazed, in Silicon Valley, which is very interesting, people are actually quite generous with their time. Like you can walk up to someone and say, hey, can I spend 15 minutes? Now, the idea is not to sit down and wait for them to teach you something in 15 minutes. The idea is like, hey, I was solving this problem and I kind of ran into these scenarios. Like, what do you think? Like, try to get people's feedback on your kind of on your problems, on your challenges.
Yeah.
I think these are the three things that would be the most important traits.
Right. Thank you, Aaron.
All right.
That was a great episode.
You're welcome.
This was Princeton Startup TV episode number 11. Be so good, we cannot ignore you.